Hello and good afternoon. Today on our first day of the Elevate Festival under the theme of transition, I am now happy to welcome on stage two speakers who are here, a third one who will join us online. I will introduce them quickly, briefly, in a few minutes or in a second or something. But first, I want also to give you a bit of a background. Who is here and why are we here and what are we here for the next about 90 minutes? So under the title, Elevate, of course, that's the festival name, Mental wealth. So it's about psychological capital, again, a reference to markets. But in fact, I'm not going to talk a lot about markets today, and altogether, I'm not going to talk so much myself, although being the psychologist here in the room and being happy to invite a sociologist, an economist, I believe, and an architect. On stage, we will now dig deeper, and this is, of course, what you need to do if you want to find resources, if you want to go to the source of things, you also need to dig deeper. And so this is what we're going to do now. We're going to look beneath a surface, beneath also some common interpretations of what is it that an individual needs in times like these to cope with the stressful situations. Maybe from the way I'm using my voice now, you can see this is not how me as a psychologist, I don't believe that it's only up to you yourself, how to deal with our times of crisis. It's a question of society. So progress is not an individual matter. It's a team sport. And I believe it's very necessary to look at it from very different perspectives. And the perspectives we are inviting today to look into the mental resources that we as individuals, as groups, but really also on a larger global context, need to not only survive, but really to strive. It's possible to look for the good. It's possible to dream. It's possible to hope. It's possible to get active. Is here being featured in one person who is happily replacing another one. I will talk about this also in a second. I am now happy to welcome Jakob Bielebel on stage. You will also talk about your project, your initiatives, the things you're doing in order to, I believe you're growing already some of the resources, societies and individual needs with the endeavors you're doing in the cultural, in the creative, in the arts, and also the political innovation you're doing. So this is Jakob Bielebel from Aktionsnetzwerk Nachhaltigkeit. So that's an action network based in Germany with the focus on the sustainable transformation of cultural institutions, but you also heading or founded the Green Music Initiative. But more on that later, but give a warm welcome to Jakob Bielebel. Thank you. And we are now being joined by Indy Johar online. He is in London in times of cancelled flights, but on the other hand, with some point of eco-sensitivity to it. I am sad on one hand that you're not here with us here in the room, but more than that, and this is also some way of looking at things, looking at the bright side, looking at the positive of it. You are here. We can welcome Indy Johar, who is an architect, urbanist, who is the founder of a design practice and consulting based in London, working globally with an amazing remote team and currently advising the European Union on questions of how to make the Green Deal, this whole bigger picture of the Green Deal, in terms of cities, of climate neutral cities, viable. How to bring this into life. And I will look very much forward in, after our short introduction round, start also with you and ask you to elaborate a bit on this idea of building mental wealth, because to be honest, we grabbed in this title. It's a title of a paper you and your team developed on mental wealth for this very session. But before, let us also say again hello to Daniel Goertz, the sociologist, social theorist, writer of amazing books, who also gave us already an introductory keynote speech on the listening society. And yeah, a welcome to, in the end, to Daniel, actually. And why Jakob, I pointed out that it's a bit of a change here. Maybe some of you saw in the program that Maya Goeppel, the transformation researcher, very well-known economist, bestseller author, who also opened the festival yesterday with a very touching keynote. Today she needed to drop out for reasons that I, as a psychologist, I would definitely be in a wrong place if we were asking her to join, despite of a psychological resource theme that sometimes, and I would actually also like to elaborate on this later, people who want to bring change in the world are, of course, confronted with a lot of barriers. So this whole idea that we as a society need to develop, that you in your individual practices are teaming up for transformation, that you're bringing people together, still means that you come and bring yourself in the room, and that being open to the changes that we see also means being vulnerable. And what this can do to us is maybe also of some interest for the audience. But before Indy, is it now the moment? I would really love to hear how you, when you were writing this piece of building mental wealth, the way we live together, the necessity to infrastructure-wise find ways to to hasten the capabilities socially, emotionally, cognitive, instead of hindering what we see today as with a lot of the buildings that surround us, the way our infrastructure, also the dark matter, the systemic, that the regulations that are surrounding us. Could you please give us a bit of an introduction to your thinkings on that?
No, I'm firstly delighted to be here, and it's a real pleasure to be amongst such great company. I suppose I'm going to go straight to the matter. I think one of the biggest challenges that we face is that we're looking at societal transitions, yet we're not looking at the capacity of society to make these transitions. And the capacity and the capability of society to make these transitions is what I would say is the mental wealth of a society. Right now in the UK, 80% of the population has less than £500 in their bank accounts, which basically means that we've created precarity, and I'm just using this as a symbol. We've created a society which is precarious and vulnerable to fear, because actually the resilience of society does not exist to be able to make complex decisions. At the same time, if you look at any of the climate change facts that we're starting to face, where we're looking at 3.5 degrees temperature rise, not 1.5 degrees, 3.5 to 4 degrees, food price inflation, all these issues are of such an order that they feed into precarity. Now, to make the scale of decisions that we need to make in Europe, and to democracies to make those decisions together, we have to build a capability of society to make those decisions. And this, I think, is one of the most least understood issues that I think are least discussed issues. Our capacity of societies to make decisions, we do not have the capacity, the quality of decision-making in society to be able to deal with the transitions that we're talking about. Which is why, if I'm being provocative, I think it's more convenient to lie to each other than to actually talk about the scale of the truth. The scale of the truth, which would mean that 250 million homes across Europe need to be retrofitted. We don't have the hydrocarbons to build, to mine the materials to retrofit the homes. In Britain alone, to retrofit those homes would cost $1.45 trillion pounds. We are talking about 68% of businesses, if they have to price social and environmental costs, they are not viable. So when people talk about living in degrowth, we are living in degrowth, where the social environmental costs are higher than the profits that are extractable from a system. So when we talk about the scale of the challenge actually we have to build the capacity of society to take the challenge. And it's a little bit like making sewers. In the 19th century, we built sewers across Europe because we needed to create a workforce which was effectively reliable, predictable, and able to produce labor, predictable labor for a machined economy. If we want to make this transition, we're going to have to build the new capabilities of society to be able to make that transition. And that is a foundation both of the complexity of the decisions and the sense-making capacity of society, the sensing and sense-making capacity, as well as actually the foundational environments. And a final thing I'd add is that we must understand that our fundamental environment right now is regressive to that. So not just money, but air pollution, sound pollution, sleep quality, all these things are fundamentally destroying a societal capacity for cognitive capabilities. Every industrial revolution has been pre-started by actually an educational and human development revolution. We are missing the human development revolution, which is necessary for the transition that we're facing. And that, to me, is going to be about our mental wealth as society. And the mental wealth is a signature. It's not about just our mental wealth. It's using that as a signal for all the other integrated ideas of one health of society. That's the foundation of this transition. I hope that helps.
Thank you, Indy. So just to summarize quickly, you're saying that in our times where pollution, for instance, is kind of eating up cognitive capacities or social capacities in the ways that we would actually need to be empowered, to be capable to transform, is also one of the reasons why, if I got it correctly, you and your practice with Dark Matter Labs is also involved in transforming, yet you meet a lot of lack. There is not enough money for the retrofitting of housing you were mentioning. Is this the point you were also making?
Because the sound was... But it's also more fundamental than that. I don't think we as societies can make the scale of decisions legitimately. That, I think, is a much more fundamental problem, is how do we legitimately, and I think democracy, Europe is at this moment the heart and the last remaining quarter of democracy. We talk about democracy not as in the idea of the state as a democratic state, but democracy as an idea of society being able to make complex decisions.
Yes.
And we need to be able to make complex decisions. And those decisions require, I would say, a deep idea of mental wealth. And that is both an environmental idea, that is effectively the resource idea and the resilience idea and the cognitive capacity as a function of that. And I think Daniel's Metamodern work and other works actually fundamentally, I think, is saying and build and advocates that in a more advanced way as well, I think.
Thank you. And Daniel, I believe you want to jump in here.
Well, yeah, I just wanted to say, obviously, you didn't hear perhaps the hour here before, Indy, but I was making, not in a sustainability or resilience sense, the exact same arguments, but simply that it's, if you look at it psychologically at the micro level and so forth, or micro sociological level of how we interact, who we are as human beings, what we're stuck in everyday life, it's just not viable to see us, just us, doing that. And the dark side of what you're saying, and you can correct me here if you want, but the dark side is within the, are we capable within the bounds of democratic institutions, right? So we need to seriously upgrade what we can do as democratic institutions, or else we default and not doing enough, and we begin to panic and we begin to sell out the democratic institutions. And I guess it's arguably partly already happening in the world. And when we sell out the democratic institutions, what the attractor point becomes, a fairly undesirable one, but it's something along the lines of gated communities for rich populations under eco-fascism, under something like eco-fascism. It doesn't necessarily have to be a race-based or ethnic-based fascism, but some sort of very hierarchical, top-down, very manipulative, very centralized, very violent power. And the degree of violence would then correspond to the degree of panic that we experience. So, yeah, that if we don't do what Iddi is talking about, we're probably in for eco-fascism, and we're not going to have cute events like these ones.
And right? It relates also to what Maya Göbel yesterday said, that in fact, we're talking about sustainable development goals. We're talking about something very important here. You, Daniel, mentioned also the addition that inner developmental goals need to be pursued as well. But most importantly, she raised the point that it's not a question of looking in the global at the global south and talking about developing countries there, but in fact, all of us countries are developing countries in the sense that democracy, the ways we are listening to each other, talking with each other, the way our infrastructure, our administration, for instance, are built up, need to develop according to the requirements, to the challenges we're facing, right?
Yeah. I mean, one thing I was just going to say, building on Daniel and what you've been saying, is that our democracies were imagined for predictable linear systems. You could look, and it takes 18 months to make a policy, or maybe even 4 years. Government is now run by WhatsApp. That's not a kind of joke. It's been the reality of governments around the world, whether you talk about British government or Bangladesh government. They were making decisions on WhatsApp. Now, why I say that, in an age of volatility, that will be an issue. As simultaneously, unless we can build legitimacy about these decisions, we will end up in a situation where politicians cannot construct the political consensus for around or legitimacy on those decisions. So we either end up with anarchy or breakdown of state, or we end up with eco-fascism. So this requires us to have a fundamental issue, as Daniel's rightly pointing out. Unless we build a deeper idea of democracy, where we build the sensing capacity, the sense-making capacity, and the decision-holding capacity and agency of society, not just decision, agency of society, to create the politics for politicians. And this is a deep sense of politics. It's not the kind of opinions, it's the capability for the Overton windows to be built in a new way. And I think that requires us to really reimagine democracy in a hard sense. And that's at a constitutional sense, I think we need to be embracing it. Our current democratic system was designed for industrial societies, and that does not build the mental health at the deeper level of society to be able to advance the issues. And that's why politicians are caught responding to smaller and smaller Overton windows and no longer next to the reality of the facts. The facts are inconvenient truths.
And Jakob, if I understood you correctly, your work with the cultural institutions, it's also work in the political system. You're working also as an advisor for the Ministry of Cultural Affairs in Germany. So in this very special, but on the other hand, also very large industry, what kind of, I don't know, is it the momentum? What kind of momentum do you see in this capabilities of transforming, or what are the barriers you're experiencing? How do you see change happening or not?
Well, to be honest, what Indy's been describing and what you pointed out in your speech was that we are somehow in a constant situation in which we are either ignorant or overwhelmed or panicking. This can only last for such a long time. You can't stay in that mode for more than 2 years, 3 years. So the cultural sector actors we are working with kind of longing to move out of that dark niche into action. So we're trying to ask ourselves what can help us to build that muscle we need for that transition. Because that transition basically is how to get from here to there. And it is kind of a muscle what we need, and if you use a muscle often, it gets stronger and you get faster and you get quicker where you want to go. And like Indy pointed out, all our institutions, our systems, haven't put enough effort into building that muscle. The thing with that muscle, and this is why we work in the cultural sector, is you shouldn't overuse that muscle. Yeah. So we are trying to somehow build some kind of muscle memory. Mm-hmm. So you start small, you learn, oh, it works out, it's doable, instead of, oh, I'm panicking, I can't. So we build tiny, 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 tiny steps. And this, from our point of view, is the only way, because if you look at it from the end goal, so to say, we are bound to fail. Mm. Are we ever going to be climate neutral? And the last thing I want to say is, and this really springs to my mind when you were giving your speeches, we became like experts in goal setting. Mm. So we have this goal and that goal. And the more goals we have, the less we actually do. So we're kind of putting the goals nearer and nearer, climate neutrality, reduction targets. And when you look at the numbers, you either panic or you pray. Or what else is there to do? And I love the way that you, the way you pointed it out. We should create these moments in which we connect to that muscle which we haven't been used in the last 150 years or so, to say.
Yes, Indy.
No, I just wanted to double down on this last point. I think we don't often talk. I think this is not just a technical revolution. It's actually a cultural revolution of how we see ourselves in the world. If the Renaissance was as an idea and the kind of Enlightenment was an idea of separation of humanity and the human, individual human, from the ecosystem and the Platonicness, this is a cultural revolution of recognizing our entanglement. Mm-hmm. And that entanglement is actually a deep, profound transformation of ourself and thereby our relationship with the world. The nature is no longer a resource in a theory of entanglement. The idea of ownership doesn't really work in a theory of entanglement. So we have conceptual frames that are legacies from an enlightened world, which actually no longer work in an entangled world. So I think we are not investing enough in our cultural revolution. And that's the kind of, in a way, I would argue, Leonardo da Vinci's Vitruvian Man was actually a symbolic reference of a cultural perspective on a new relationship of what it means to be human. I think that new relationship of being human in the 21st century is going to be a cultural revolution. And it starts at that point, and I couldn't overemphasize this issue. And in a moment of crisis, it's very difficult to point toward this and spend the money towards this, because it always feels better to spend everywhere else. But actually, without the transformation of ourself, our recognition of self, and ourself in the world in a new theory, our dark matter is, and I use that term, is all of an old age, and it needs to be reinvented for that new age. But that cultural revolution is the transformative center of it.
And this cultural revolution, of course, involves different stories. And this kind of idea that we are hyper-individualistic, and it's the me economy, and it's the story I tell about myself with beautiful hashtags and captions online, to me, as a psychologist, represents mainly one thing. And it started actually by your living in India with Margaret Thatcher, with her sentence that there's no such thing as a society. Yeah, problem is there's three basic psychological needs, and one of them is relatedness. The other is autonomy. Autonomy is an important thing as well, of course. And the third is competence. But most vulnerable we are possibly, and this is of course related to how we humans are brought into the world, without the help of others, we don't get anywhere. But the beautiful aspect of the story is the other side of this coin. It's, in fact, it's the necessity of others that is the mother of invention. It has been shown many, many times that it's only in relation with others that we are actually not getting competitive mainly, but also looking for ways to solve things, to bring up new ideas. Yet again, the story that has been told and is still being told is a story of scarcity, is a story of criticism, is a story of if you dream big and look for the others, you might still be judged as being too weak to do it on your own. And these kind of stories, and I really very much believe, although it's about investments in infrastructure that we need in order to build the capacities for our cities to be fit for the transformation, many of those things are super cheap. And this, again, might sound kind of cynical, but I'm not trying to be cynical the least. I'm just wondering, with the recent news we are all following every day, we're being told how much it's going to cost us the energy arrays of prices. And as you mentioned, Indy, and it's the same sad story in Austria, many and most people don't have the money on their bank accounts to face those raising bills. Certainly not. So there is an economical and political issue at stance. Yet again, many of the things to deal with it are also rewriting stories and rewiring our brains and doing it the way Jakob was describing it. It's about change muscles, it's tiny steps, and most of it, and I believe that's again the political innovation we're needing, is to allow people to see that they can be efficient and together in groups collectively, to be invited to see that things are possible. And this is not about sugarcoating lies. No, it's inviting participation and to see that things can be changed and you play a role in this whole story. This would for me be definitely one of those changes to make use of those psychological resources. We have more than just fear, we have hopes.
Thank
I'm
you.
Looking at you
just added a few things, Irina, but I was about to tag on to you and you mostly. This thing about cultural transformation, of course, it depends on what we put in the word culture, but let's use the word narrowly for a moment. The arts. The arts are obviously culture. And if it is a transformation corresponding to the Renaissance, and this is actually my favorite example of what sort of transformation, what time we're in. So I'm glad you bring it up. Indeed, some people say, well, it's like the Axial Age. Some people say it's the new Industrial Revolution. I really think we're in something that looks like the Renaissance. And what was the Renaissance? If you look at it deeply, it was the birth of modernity. So you have a medieval world and something breaks out of it. And for the first thing that happens in these proto-capitalist North Italian cities, the first thing that happens is you start to have modern art, perspective, correctly three-dimensional art. That was the Italian side of it, or you could go to the Dutch side. And there was, they sort of have pixelated art, they added more and more details until they had almost photographic. But reality, third-person reality, entered the art world. Closely from that sprung the natural science revolution. Leonardo da Vinci particularly, why did he study anatomy? What set him off? Well, I sometimes say Leonardo DiCaprio instead of Leonardo da Vinci, but I did the right thing today. So he specifically looks at this because he wants precision, right? And from there on, you have the whole scientific revolution of the 1600s. The scientific revolution sets off what? A revolution in philosophy, the Enlightenment. The Enlightenment sets off what? Well, new societies, more liberal societies or capitalist societies, and of course, together with all of the former, the Industrial Revolution. Eventually, in the 20th century, you have truly modern politics. And it's the same principle. So third person perspective, the perspective in the painting is you can see it from anywhere. You can see the universality of the perspective. This point and that point in space are connected, they're looking at the same point, right? Then the market does the same thing, we vote with our money, the democracy does the same thing, we vote with our votes, I see it this way, you see it that way. We start to use intersubjective reality, intersubjective verification or falsification as it's called in technical terms. So the same principle starts in the arts, explodes there, and eventually transforms all of society. Even down to politics. And it has to be that way because the artist is one person and they can go by intuition and just do it. Whereas in parliamentary politics, you have to make it super explicit to put it in the legal code. You have to really say what you mean, and a majority have to support it. So of course it has to end there. But it's interesting that you're in the politics of culture. So it's sort of, I mean, it's sort of a cycle. So the politics of today can open up the Pandora's box, hopefully with good surprises, of the arts. And which is, like, why are people like us, like Indy, yourself, me, Irina, why are we at an arts festival? Why aren't we at, I suppose we do go to other venues. But there's a certain logic to it. There's a certain logic to it that the arts have to come first. So I just wanted to make that point, not to politicize all the cool art projects everybody does, right? But just to say that, well, in terms of hope, right? If you can, just what you can do with the imagination, right? If you're sensitive, like if you have that depth, if you're sensitive to those historical processes that are happening in culture.
The role of imagination, Indy, I know you also think quite a lot about it. The lack or the lust for it.
Yeah, I mean, I think the thing I want to build on is what stories are we going to tell ourselves? One of the things that I worry about is the stories are actually increasingly regressive. So I get stories of localism or eco-villages are going to save us. But let me put it a different way. Every one of you in this room has got something called a microchip in it. Something, it'll be a phone, it'll be something, it has a microchip in it. That microchip, if it takes a civilization to make a pencil, which is the timber, the carbon, the aluminium, the rubber, it takes 70 billion humans and a whole planet to make one microchip. We are already living in a planetary civilization. Yet our governance infrastructures and our ideas of self are based on industrial theses. So when people talk about the singularity, I'm less and less interested in the singularity of AI. I'm interested in what is, I think, a planetary singularity between human-machine ecological systems. So for the first time, I would say the Montreal Agreement, which was about dealing with ozone layer, was about a planetary consciousness making a planetary level correction. Climate change will simultaneously and similarly have to be a planetary consciousness transformation. We have the ability to sense at the planetary scale. We have to build the organizational capacity to be able to reflect that. Our biological and ecological systems are already working at a planetary scale. Whether you look at the Sahara Desert, dust from the Sahara Desert, actually giving nutrients to the Amazon as a key part of it. I think one of the biggest transformations that we have is what are the stories we're going to tell ourselves? And too often the stories are actually reminiscence. They're us reminiscing to an idyll of a 15th century village that we will all somehow survive in this village by ourselves. When our food systems, our information systems, our material systems are now operating at a planetary scale. And I think the biggest challenge that we face is how do we dream for a planetary civilization which isn't a fascist model, which allows for a different way of dreaming. So what is a planetary singularity which isn't actually a totalitarian model? And I think we have to understand that every place is part of a metabolic flow. We are knots. Vienna, Graz is a knot in a flow of materials, information, nutrients, other things, but massively interdependent with the rest of the world. Brexit is an illusion of an idea because actually Britain is massively interconnected with the world in many, many flows. So how do we build a new stories for this age which recognize a new reality, not just at the individual level, but actually our political theory, organizational level, I think also really important and will require us to find new theories of governance based on that. So what are these new stories and words? What are the lexicon of these new stories is really important. So what are, you know, increasingly, how do we move from noun-based languages to verb-based languages to deal with the processing quality of the world that we recognize, which our machine capabilities are able to not only recognize, but work with? So I think we're living in this deep cultural transformation of both taxonomy, language, grammar, and then effectively also the nature of actually the stories that we tell. And that is the deep work that I think a cultural revolution has to be part of and actually build the humility of being part of it. And exactly as Daniel says, that is the beginning of a much larger arc of transformation.
Oh yeah, there is some applause here in the room. I don't know if you can hear it. And you were now talking about let's not do the regression, but do the other direction. And this brought to mind to me something, Daniel. I don't know how much you would like to talk about it or how much you can tell us about it, but there is this Nordic secret I heard about that when you, all of you, were confronting the mismatch of the industrial age setup we're having right now to what we're actually living in, a planetary, globalized world, democracy maybe, hopefully. And this Nordic secret, as far as I understood, is an analysis of what happened in the Scandinavics in the 18th, 19th century in response to the changes from the agricultural society to the industrial society, which of course was a big change in the ways people live together, how they consume, how they produce, how they made. Those questions were all turned upside down. And as you all mentioned, most of the institutions we're having right now are built on the premises of the industrial society. And only a few countries, namely the Scandinavics, were responding to these changes, not only with qualifying people with hard skills, like, for instance, the Humboldt idea and the Volksbildungs idea with Volksbildungs and Arbeiter, the workers' traditions that also looked for upskilling people with technical skills. But in the Scandinavics, if I got it right, there was also a movement that allowed people to develop psychologically. Do you have any insights on that?
Well, so basically, this is a book by some friends of I'm not sure if you and you know them, but Indy and I know them very well, who wrote about, well, they basically look at this history of this update of Scandinavian societies around the year 1900, roughly.
And update up the operating system, kind of.
Well, yeah, and I mean, you said it already, basically. But let's highlight a few things. One thing is that it came from actually deep in German culture, Germanic culture, the romantic tradition. Bildung is a romantic idea. So it's about being in love with the world and getting people to feel in love with life through the richness of embodied life experience with multiple perspectives of reality. And those ideas did make it into the life work of a certain Danish reformer that was very, very influential, which then created schools for adults, but not necessarily vocational schools, right? So you would support adult development. And likewise, that the Swedish Prime Minister at the time was speaking that language. We have to support the spiritual development of our population, which is a pretty cool thing that somebody was talking about 100 years ago. So apparently, there was a phase shift, and I mean, it's a question open to debate. But is this the secret, the Nordic secret of why? Why Scandinavian countries have had such good figures in terms of equality, well-being, health, and so forth, and human development index, and all of these things. Maybe it's a strong hypothesis, and it's one worth testing again. And given how hard pressed we are, maybe we should invest very actively in building those capacities. I want to be a little bit cautious about that example, because the risk is that we mimic that 100 years ago example a little bit too much. I mean, if you would put people, general adult population, in two-year retreat schools, it might not be such a good model today, right? You might need something else. All of these schools still exist, but they're sidelined in Swedish and Danish culture, and for a reason, right? I think you said one thing about Indy. You already mentioned one word. You said, "What's the new narrative?" And you didn't say global. You said planetary. that's interesting. Planetary much more easily includes the biosphere. It much more easily includes a geohistory. It also arguably includes non-human animals to another extent for instance, reconciliatory ecology of the design of our cities so that animals actually can live here without being, reduced to very bad life styles and so forth. So that's one word. You also said about the village. We usually agree about stuff, but this thing about the villages, eco-villages, I don't think they can save us, but they think they can be part of it. Cosmolocal. Cosmolocalism is another such. So you produce as locally as you can, but you're still through the web connected to solutions and blueprints and whatnot on a global level, and you sort of feed back to a sort of planetary communism of knowledge and cultural goods, right? While you try to create as much autonomy of food, waste, and water. And energy, of course, as you can on the local level, because that will empower people, and that will also spread the power relations of society. If people can't, pull a lever and close the tap water, or the heat, for that matter, then they don't have as much control over you, and then you can actually democratize society. This is a very big thing in Dark Matter Labs as well. So that cosmolocal narrative is important. There are enthusiasts who really love it. I'm a little bit cautious about it because oftentimes if you do the math, it's going to be more sustainable with like actually transporting things for a while than producing it everywhere. So, just saying planetary cosmolocal is a good place to start.
And cultural. And Jakob, there is a quote of yours. You once said at festivals like Elevate, can serve as a sort of training ground for a better society. And now that we heard about this cosmolocal, or maybe also ways of how the Scandinavians in the 18th century, they actually introduced people to those retreats to grow psychologically from all echelons of society. So sometimes culture and art can be, on one hand, the forerunners of societal change, but oftentimes also, not being cherished by everyone, or who is everyone, but anyways. I was wondering how you think about the capabilities, the possibilities of arts, cultures, and the transformations you see there, the people who you see there, you work with, in broadening those kind of processes.
Wow, that's a long question. let me try to answer that. So culture by itself is a CrossFit program for that muscle. I talked about the muscle we need to create a muscle memory to create a transformation the way we want it.
Yeah.
Getting from here to there, and best we have an idea what that there is. Otherwise, we reach an air there, which we don't want to go to. So in culture, it's a CrossFit because you learn so many things. If you attend a festival, for example, you for 3 days really engulf yourself in an experience, which is at best very different to what you experience at home. So if young people go to festival for 3 days, basically what they do, they throw away their passports or put it away and say, I'm a different person. They dress up. They experience with drug, with love, with everything, with community. And they come back and they learn something. And that learned is not on a rational level. They learned something different. They learned how things could work out. Because that's the funny thing about festivals. At a festival, Roskilde, 100,000 people, Glastonbury, 85,000 people, whatever there is, Burning Man, 75,000 people, very little isms actually taking place there. People somehow get along. And very often when I'm sitting with politicians in interviews and they approach me like, Jakob, we understand young people attend festivals to forget about their lives at home. I said, no, it's actually the other way around. They remember how things could work out if everybody would look at each other and look for each other. And I'd like your term, the listening society. Was it a term, listening society? And I was thinking, what would actually happen if we would actually start to listen to each other? what would actually happen if we would start to listen not to each other, but to what is around us? I'm not going on the Gaia global level thing like Maya now, but what would actually happen if we would start to listen and would really understand what it makes to us? And I want to add one last thing, because I understood you have a sweet tooth for Nordic philosophers or Nordic ways of thinking. I want to tell you a story about a great Nordic philosopher. I'm aware most of you will know it. He has never written a book. He's a musician. His name is Morten Harket from A-ha. You know A-ha? Yeah? Take on Me, great song. When I was working in the music industry, I had a meeting with Morten Harket. We were doing interviews. So I spent a few days with him, and I got to know him. And he told me about his sustainability things. And I was asking him, why are you doing that? I mean, you're an artist, you are famous, you don't have to do it. And he said a very beautiful thing. He said, Jacob, there was a point in my life in which I realized I was conscious. And then I said, yeah, what does that mean? He said, at the very moment I realized I was conscious, a few seconds later I realized I was responsible. Mm. And now I have a decision to make. Either that responsibility is a burden or it is a beauty. And Morten Harket, the lovely artist, said, I made a decision that that responsibility should be of beauty. So this is why I'm doing that thing. So he didn't put any like heavy stuff in it. He said, just, it's a decision. If I want to be conscious, if I rejoice in consciousness, I have a responsibility. And that can either be a burden or a beautiful thing. And I want it to be a beautiful thing because I love my life. I want it to be beautiful. And that's so easy. I said, Morten, you're a genius.
And Indy, you're nodding and smiling. How many times are you, when now sitting in Graz, a very beautiful city, it's really unfortunate you cannot be here. The role of beauty, aesthetics, but you're now in this realm of bureaucracy facing the transformation of our cities for climate neutrality. Is there any place for beauty in those discussions?
I think exactly as was said just a moment ago. I think it is that form of beauty. It is the ability to not see things as a burden, but to see maybe a floor made of clay as a thing of beauty because you can appreciate its appropriateness for the moment. And beauty is not an abstraction of what you see in a magazine. It is an idea of being to see the perfection of something in its moment and its context and its relationships. And that requires a new capacity to see. And I think this is one of the things I would say our beauty has been colonized by, all of our beauties have been colonized by effectively a very thin form of capital and a very thin form of accumulation models, which have actually broken our idea of relational contextual forms of beauty and the appreciation to construct it. And I think maybe more important than the word beauty as an object, but actually the act of seeing things being beautiful, to be fullness of beauty, I think is even more important because they actually have an emergence to it. So I think these are important things, but they're not the things of beauty that we classify. We've reduced them to being visual things. But I think beauty is a much more profound thing than its visualness. And I think it's the appropriateness of responsibility and the respect that we as humans engage in our entanglement in the world. So I think there is a new beauty to be born. And this is where I have to say, you know, in spirit, the new European Bauhaus had the opportunity to engage a new theory of beauty and a new theory of beauty and relationality and a new theory of being human in a new world. And I feel we need to rise up further in that conversation and take it to its actual new relational level. I think it's not about repeating the Bauhaus, but actually finding a new theory of the Bauhaus, which won't be about industrial production, but it will be a new idea of relational production to be fundamentally different. And it will be a production which is different, right? So this is the other thing I want to talk about. We have, in Sweden, we consume 27 tons of material per person a year. The global average is 2 tons. We cannot consume that much matter. We know in terms of the transition we're facing, we're almost certainly going to have to dematerialize our economy, and we're going to have to make it durable, and we're going to have to make it circular. So the theory of, and we're going to have to make it all of this much more relational. Now, that is a new basis of beauty, and within it will be new ideas of value. And the thing, the wrapper around the world will be different. 80% of the value of a startup is intangible, right? It's not the material goods of the startup. So what does beauty look like? What does our economy and society look like when 80% of it is intangible? And I think in those things, things like beauty or beautiful become really important because they're the fineness of appropriateness. It's about a new appropriateness that's really critical. So I think it's really important.
Another clapping.
We find ourselves agreeing again, but we'll pick a fight afterwards. We promise. So the role of beauty. There is such a thing as real beauty and false beauty, let's start in this end. In order for a transformative transition to a reasonably sustainable, resilient, and happy society to be possible, we need a huge carrot. And the carrot has to, you know, really electrify the soul, has to put us on fire. It has to be beautiful. It has to be a place that you wouldn't resist. And right now, unfortunately, speaking of eco-fascism, as we spoke of before, what's shown up on my radar is that the middle classes of Western countries look up to Singapore, which is a very interesting place in many ways, and a fascinating city. But it is at the same time a fairly authoritarian or paternalist, at least, city and or system. And it is right now the world's mecca or capital of solar punk, not Graz, which is a super interesting place, which could be the mecca
solar punk.
Yes, solar punk. So this aesthetic where you turn everything green and you sort of look on. Like, what are the solutions that are really beautiful that marry technology to nature, human to environment, and sort of make this thriving green aesthetic, right? And that really speaks to also the middle class, the thing that you couldn't resist, right? So for these transformative things, they really need that design, that touch. And right now, it's a little bit as though, unfortunately, fairly authoritarian powers are hijacking that beauty and creating a Disneyland version of it. It looks, but it's not a very sustainable system or city, and it's not even democratic. People basically leave each other alone. It's not such a rich civil society and so forth in the places that are today leading the solar punk revolution. And I think you could go farther than that. If you want to go in seriously and look at what fascism is, one way to see it is that it's when you put aesthetics, mm-hmm. like just your own taste, the truth be damned, above everything else. So it's like, okay, I don't care if it's good or if it's true, we're going to have the coolest uniforms, we're going to have shiny black suits and shiny helmets and the best rifles, and we're going to stand on perfect lines, we're going to make everything according to this pattern that we figured, that a few people figured out, and we're just going to plaster it on everything. Because we like that, right? And that's not real beauty. That's when beauty or a hysterical grasp for beauty from an impoverished soul tries to make beauty colonize morality and truth. Real beauty comes from when we together are surprised by what the truth tells us is morally right to do. And then we can design from there, right? For instance, you go inside the neutrino chamber in Japan. I don't remember what it's called, but it's like this huge, huge, huge chamber of bubbles of gold. And it's for looking at neutrinos, but it looks like the most sublime artwork in the world. Why is that? Beauty just follows truth. We want to find out what's true about the deepest things in the universe just happen to be beautiful, right? And yeah.
beauty as a resource, kind of. And Jakob, I have seen you writing about days in about discussions that today beauty or art, more generally speaking, doesn't always apply to beauty standards, or whatever. But it's sometimes being treated by politicians, also of course the money issuing organizations, as superficial, as something we don't need as a society these days, that in terms of carbon dioxide reduction, we would rather stop going to festivals, we would rather not have another art exhibition, because altogether it's superfluous, who needs it? But I think from what we just saw, I mean, of course, in every power there's the potential of abuse, but I think you also have some use for beauty aesthetics, festivals, and arts, even in our times.
Definitely. I mean, like Daniel put it out, beauty can be such a powerful force. At the very same time, we are surrounded by the mimicry of beauty, things we think are beautiful. And the true nature of beauty is, can be painful at times, painful to look at. And when we realize we shouldn't close our eyes, we should listen, we will move into a space where we all of a sudden are, in connection to what is actually happening. And like what Maya said yesterday, what you were pointing out, we somehow at some point lost that connection. We pretend that's beauty, we pretend that's efficient, we pretend that's somehow right and that is fair. And if we would ask each and everyone in the room and all over the world, nobody would say, this is beauty, this is fair, this is right. But we always pretend there's a third person saying this is the way it needs to be. So could we just dare to listen? Dare to dream that it would be possible, and then create that way towards that. And this is why art is of such an importance, because in art there is no failure. You can't fail with art. And we are so afraid of failure in reaching the non-reachable goals that we are somehow back out. And every day when I wake up, I pray that we have the power to push through, to pull through, to not back off, to back up the ones who are actually doing it, to have their backs. And then, and this is what we can learn from art and from music, why not create some kind of momentum movement? You said revolution. I said, why not create something like the Wu-Tang Clan of the transition? Like Maya might be RZA, she's like the mastermind. I'd be like old dirty bastard, I'm a bit crazy. And you can be like not Method Man, I don't know. And then we create that momentum. Yeah, like everybody wants to be with Wu-Tang Clan. Or The Clash, because I was listening to punk when I was younger. The Clash, they were so important and so successful because The Clash was the last gang in town. And you could feel they would watch their backs. They would push through. They wouldn't back off. They wouldn't bend down. And let's create that movement towards beauty, but with the power we need. We need power and we need direction to really rejoice in the beauty like Martin from AHA was describing it.
And also keep yourself going. And you just mentioned to have ourselves and others keep our backs free from some of those burdens, because in fact you are carrying something. You need your muscles be strengthened.
And like with the tech team, I mean, if you are like on the last 10% of your energy you have to tech, then I'll be jumping in, then Maya's jumping in, then Daniel's, then Indy's jumping in. So that's the way we create a movement.
And it's the way like movies are made, for instance. I love it. Last time I was at the cinema, and I haven't been there a lot since the pandemic. And I really hated that when once you watch a movie on some of those streaming platforms, you always get cut off the moment all the names. All the many, many, many names have their moment on stage, because a movie is a mission team that has accomplished such beauty, hopefully in one way or the other, and it's hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people, and it's minutes it's taking to have those people featured. But you're being cut off once you watch it in
a streaming platform. It's actually a super important moment, because the director says that's the moment in which you integrate the effect of the movie. Nothing is happening, you just see names, but you have to have that minutes for the movie to really integrate
within
you. Sink in,
yeah. The time to digest also. By the way, digesting very philosophical, and as I mentioned already in the beginning of the session, we will dig deeper, we will look for sources, resources, psychological resources that can be built, that can be also, or need to be established democratic-wise, that have to transform our institutions. Is there any ideas, takes, surprises, questions in the audience? We could start to open also our field. Yeah, there is one, and we need a microphone, just a second.
Thank you for your ideas. One thing which came up again and again was like, you try telling it different ways. For example, now you're speaking of the movie of the credits. You mentioned being conscious, meaning having like also like a sense of attention for a moment. And you, I think Indy mentioned things like the state of our emotions, which part it has in our ability to make a transition. And what are your thoughts? Because I think the mastermind which shapes on our attention these days is surveillance capitalism. Like, and shapes when we, which information we see, which art we consume. Like, it's one step further. How much, what are your thoughts on how surveillance capitalism affects what you just discussed?
What I would say is that surveillance capitalism, and by that you mean the platform economies that we currently have a capital reinforcement mechanism. So they will reinforce the capital to which they're constructed from. And that's basically just a fractal that's buried into their DNA. So you're absolutely right that our current institutions are going to replicate the forms. Now, what that does mean is that they are there to advance and accelerate, whether it's kind of fear, precarity, these emotions. And what we've got is a surveillance capital that is actually focused on attention. And the easiest form of attention is based on very primal emotions. Complex thought, complex discussions like beauty are actually very difficult to have. And I'll give you a good example. So we did a little bit of a trial where we asked people whether they liked universal basic income. It was an opinion where people came randomly off the street and then we asked them. 74% of people said they hated universal basic income because everyone else would be lazy, right? Now, a day later, 8 hours later, we asked the same people who had been in a deliberative space what they thought, and 80% of them said they actually liked UBI. They thought UBI was a great idea. So now here the key thing is, the key thing was not that they had done deliberation. The key thing was that they had de-othered each other. So the guy with a turban and a big beard was no longer some scary guy, was actually somebody they could relate to. So the act of 8 hours, what had happened was we de-othered everyone, so their decision-making model had changed. So how you construct decision-making models and the biases in them are going to affect how we construct our societal decision-making models. And our decision spaces have become very narrow and very reactive. And that's because we've been using a very particular, and Daniel can speak very eloquently to this, whereas our technologies are based on actually triggering very simple emotive responses rather than dealing with the deep cognitive emotional responses that are required, and that's spaces for that. And space, physical space, was a very powerful form of doing that. So I just wanted to share that with you. So I think this is a really important point, but this is why we need to be more cognizant about the spaces we create in society, and platforms are just one type of space, and how do we create the other forms of deliberative spaces for different decision-making models. I think the spaces of society are constructing our politics, not the politicians, right? The spaces we've created for deliberation is constructing our politics. And that, I think, really must teach us something about how we're informing our societal decision-making capacity. So I couldn't agree more. I hope that sort of a little bit responds to your question.
Thank you. And Jakob, you also want to...
Very short answer to a tricky question, because obviously the answer is yes. What you've been describing really puts some pressure on everything we do. But I wouldn't end there. I would just try to have a closer look. Like Daniel pointed out in his keynote, capitalism or surveillance capitalism is something like a machine we built, we, not them. It's not us and them. It's a machine which we built for an end. We had an idea in mind what it should deliver. And if we allow ourselves to really look at the machine and deciding to understand if that machine is actually delivering what we intended in the beginning. So you said attention. Yes, we have to put the attention there. It doesn't mean that we have the answer yet. Like Maya is always saying, you don't need to have the answer to ask the right question. But we have to look at that machine and understand if it's delivering what it was intended to. The machine which was built to an end, if it's still the end, or has the machine become the end by itself? So, I think the short answer would be yes, it has an impact. The longer answer is, yeah, but let's look closer, let's see. The machine has been built by us, so we can rebuild it, we can build a new machine. There are myriads of ideas, kind of machines, what we might need. Why not give it a try?
And I also need to jump in here from my perspective as a psychologist, and tomorrow we will have the talk about digital humanism by Professor Hannes Werthner. And what this initiative also seeks for is finding ways, and first, of course, breaking the ways surveillance capitalism is now eating up on our brains. So in the early beginnings of our discussion today, I was talking to India about the pollution that is taking some of our capacities, because our brains are functioning under air we are breathing, and so, of course, it is affecting our ways to think if we breathe bad air. It's very closely related. It's one thing, the brain and the body. And same goes for surveillance capitalism. If there is too much attention, and most of those models, the market models of surveillance capitalist, and we have the flags now on the Graz Dome at the Schlossberg with the GAFA, with all those large companies that are now monopolizing actually the ways we are using the internet, the ways we are using the machine, they also are somehow programmed with, as you said, with an intention, but the way they are monetized is it's their harvesting our vulnerabilities. And I have really to say I'm very, very sorry that many psychologists gave a lot of insights in how people's minds can be tricked, treated, being used like the most comfortable, the most less energy-consuming way. So in fact, our brain and body budget was kind of misused by most of those companies and the many, many ways we're using them today, the recommendation systems we're using and so on, they are now built on our human vulnerabilities. Yet, again, we can change it. It's again, it's about decisions, it's about opting out, it's about being more conscious in the ways we're using it. And of course, the people who are here, the hackers, the hipsters, the hippies, all of us, we can also engage in building the machine anew and less on the vulnerabilities, but more on the capabilities. We can grow as individuals, we can grow as societies. We are not only the little screaming 2 years old that needs to have their little needs satisfied immediately. Yes, Indy.
I was just going to add one quick thing. I think our theory of machines has come out of a theory of control. And control has been a theory of how we've tried to organize the world. It's a kind of control theory. Now imagine a new theory of machines, which is about ennoblement, to ennoble us, to make us wiser. That's a different way of seeing and learning. So I think we're going to move from a theory of control to a theory of deep learning systems or ennobling systems. That's a different theory of how we construct machines and machine-human relationships. And currently, the risk is that we are embodying control theory, because in a linear predictable world, in a top-down vertical world model, industrial world model, control was a mechanism to harmonize and produce universal products. Whereas in a complex emergent world, you need a new theory of organizing, which is about a theory of learning capacity, and not only learning, but ennoblement of capacity at the front end. So I think there's a new theory of machine-human interfaces that has to be built and enhanced. And I think in that is a new theory of democracy between humans and machines, right? It's not just about what is the role. And I think this is a deeper transformation of democracy. Democracy of industrial age was still an industrial control model. And I think this is a greater emancipation of democracy that I think has to be part of it, but it has to be part of our machine-human ecological systems in an integral way. Sorry, I just wanted to build on what you were saying, Irina.
Who wants to also stir up the conversation? Who has remarks, questions? Yeah, there's one, the lady in the black dress.
Adding to, or building to both the last points you've been making, given that we know all the tricks and mechanics and measures that the GAFAs and whom else have been developing in order to trick our minds, to trick our brains, to grab our attention, to keep us hooked in those kind of systems. You said something about an authoritarian system later that I think no one wants. But given that we know all these kind of things, isn't it probably our responsibility to use those kind of metrics and mechanics and measures and shape people's behavior in a good way, like the extreme form of nudging? Also build that into our political systems, build that in political action and measures, and build that into the new technologies that we design, the new interfaces that we design to really nudge or even potentially force a bit people into the right mode to be
responsible. Yes, Daniel.
So I think this really hits the nail on the head, this question about, this was also sort of what I was talking about earlier, that, okay, if we take the step from a postmodern critical mode of being, sensibility, consciousness, whatever you want to call it, expression of culture, into a metamodern constructive or reconstructive one, you have to wrestle difficult questions. That's sort of the price. You get hope, but you also never get to be the good guy. Exactly. You need to always think about, okay, is this right? Am I the good guy? Am I doing harm? And I think the question that you ask goes right back to the beginning of this discussion, to what Indy said. It's about democratic capacity building. We don't have enough democratic capacity to, with legitimacy, do nudging at the depth, level of sensitivity, and just width, like just how much it fathoms, how much it grasps, to legitimately do that. Rather, if with today's fairly crude representative, democratic, and bureaucratic and technocratic systems, we try to do those things, it will be manipulative. And as manipulation, it will experience resistance, right? So it's sort of a race against time to deepen our democracies. And to be experimental about ways of life there. And then there's a sort of feedback cycle between, okay, democracy gets deepened, then you can build a more listening society with much more public support and deliberative support for how we want to be affected by the material agents around us, by our buildings and cell phones and information flows and whatnot, and vehicles and shops and everything. And then that helps us develop into different beings. We are different people in different relationships with different desires, because desires is very, very socially mediated. And from there on, we can develop yet deeper democracy, right? Because we now have different discussions going on and different ways, different languages of grasping new realities that otherwise were out of our grasp or outside of our scope. So that's the one part that I and the most important part, I also briefly want to add, there is such a thing as, we used to think in terms of Marxism, or people used to think in terms of Marxism, that we went from agriculture to industrialism. It becomes more and more popular in this digital and informational time, to think in terms of something like an informational Marxism. You switch information communication regimes through history. And today, we live in a corrupted early age information regime where companies, private companies, have usurped by a monopoly or by first mover advantage, have usurped the informational commons and the informational architecture of our communications. So if there is a level of, like, the commons or the platforms, they shouldn't be run as capitalist companies. So it is a sort of a Marxist in a struggle to retake that control, right? Not the means of production. You don't have to chase every factory owner of a little ice cream factory. But it's not okay that so few people own so fundamental infrastructure of our societies. It's absolutely crazy, and it is a form of authoritarianism, and it is a form of corruption. It will lead to more corruption, more authoritarianism. So there needs to be some sort of pretty tough resistance, if you ask me, a sort of Marxist resistance to this. And once that exists, I think we could go deeper and deeper, right, in actually creating nudging, right, and so forth. But that's my answer. Guessing we might have different opinions.
I was just thinking while you were mentioning this idea that now the commons that have been created online have not found yet an appropriate or even a democratic way of being governed. And this reminds me also on what Yanis Varoufakis is recently voicing, that in fact, the way Google invented some sort of what he calls a human right, the human right to information, the way Google was actually opening up, and Maya again yesterday, she was also talking about the potentials, for instance, living in places on this planet where the internet connection on your mobile device is really a source, again, a source of information, but also about of liberation. Mm-hmm. And that, in fact, Google, who still treats it, and of course is still allowed to treat it as a commodity, as a market model for themselves only, should actually be now told in one way or the other that, in fact, it's great. There's a new human universal right. Let's look at it that way. But in fact, it's not you as a company who has to make money out of a human right. This is not how we deal human rights, actually. Yes, so on the surveillance capitalism, which is kind of not surprising in an Elevate festival context that we veered up to that direction. I love
it. We ticked every box. Marxism, capitalism, Foucault.
And it's not only the economy stupid, it's also the psychology lovely, I hope. I think this is very important to see and to say. Yet, the floor is still open. Are there more remarks, ideas, critics?
Maybe another thing. I was recently watching a talk of Mr. Hopkins. Is he called the way, or Hopkins? What's this called? It's a surveillance scientist. No matter what. He was talking a lot about the power, not of only our emotions, but a lot of the power of imagining a transition. So what are your thoughts on that? Like, what can we even imagine how the future will look like and have these pictures in our minds? And talk about this power a bit, maybe. We'd like to hear your thoughts on that.
Yes, Jakob already raises his hand.
A lovely question, because it gives me the opportunity to really drop something which for me is of utmost importance. The capability to dream of a desired future. And the big question, we are so fed with mimicries of beauty, we are so fed with mimicries of community, we are so fed with mimicries of how the future could look like that it seems kind of impossible at times. But I'm hoping that we are courageous enough to cough up, and really, I mean, like coughing up, really, really put some effort in it to say, yes, that future is still possible, even if the odds are against us, if there are millions of possibilities that it won't take place, it won't happen, it will become even worse, there still is that tiny moment. And wherever that, even the tiniest of possibility is part of the discussion, and the tiniest of possibility for that future is heard, is spoken out and then listened properly and it's heard, it creates that, I'm lacking the word now, Möglichkeitsraum, like block.
Yeah,
thing.
There is no proper translation.
But it's
of
one of your topics.
Yeah, a way of talking about it. Yeah, room of possibilities, yet the beautiful wording itself yeah. is a German
Very
romantic.
German word. Möglichkeitsraum bei Bloch, das ist so konkrete Utopie.
Imaginary.
Ne? Concrete utopian. Ja, blah. Let's not translate German. It's a beautiful Come German on. Word.
Yes, Come indeed.
No, I'd like to build on this conversation because I think we've reduced imagination to an idea of the future. And that idea of the future has been, I think, reduced to a West Coast idea of the future, which is basically, if you look into the 2050s or 2100s written by Star Trek, Star Wars, or a series of kind of Marvel universes, which have been massively destructive, I think, on what I would say is a craft idea of imagination, where the imagination is not implanted in your head like Disney, like a kind of a prosthetic in your mind to which you seek to live up to, but an imagination which is craft-discovered in your relational context. And I think we need to start to talk about imagination not just as images of the future, but this craft capacity to see futures in relationship to that context and in relationship to that language and ways of seeing. So I think imagination is really important, but I think its current literal understanding ends up too easily being kind of visions of the future. Whereas I think it's about how we craft the future and our ability to discover, you know, for me, the best projects are the projects that don't coincide with what I had already imagined, because they went beyond my imagination into being something more than what I could imagine. And that means that they go beyond my perception of what the future is. And I think we need to go beyond our imagination. Anything that goes into our imagination is limited by what we could foresee. So how do we craft and build and craft into this future in a bigger way, I think is really important. And I think imagination may be a shackle, and a shackle that is too easily controlled. And I think we need to go beyond it.
And really call out the simulation if you see one. I really was now thinking a lot that you were making fun of your citing, quoting so many philosophers, but there is one I think that is also important in this round. It's Jean Baudrillard with the simulacrum idea, this fucked up mimicry. And really, people, if you go out and see, it's again just the idea of authenticity, the idea that can be sold to you in types of, I don't know, the next deli that opens up for fast food at lunch, that fakes, tries to give you the impression that it's been your grandmother's kitchen. It's not. And let's not waste too much time and energy in being tricked into something that is not here. Let's rather go towards what can be here, what has not been done yet, and call out the scams if you see any. And calling out also the options that you, all of you, are actually working on, is there some, I don't know, practical tips? It sounds a bit crazy now, 5 minutes before closing this round. Yet again, are there any go-to ways of working this trouble?
Yes.
Yes. And the ways you're, for instance, proposing and working on with Aktionsnetzwerk and or others?
What I'm going to pretend it's a trick, it's actually quite counterintuitive. It comes from my grandmother. My grandmother used to be a very wise woman. And being my grandmother, when I was younger, I was very hectic. I was running around all the time, doing this, doing that, doing this, doing that. And my grandmother had a very wise saying. She said, "Jacob, when you're in a hurry, better walk slowly." And this is my best trick. I think we're in such a hurry, like, oh, can't we reach that goal? And we're doing too many things here and there and there and there. So let's rather walk slowly and create that momentum, create some torque. Is that the right word, English word, torque? Like slowly moving, but with lots of power. Mm-hmm. We need torque to move into the future. Because Indy, I want to cite you. When you're talking about the future, something really sprang to my mind. I think there is no such thing like a future. There's no such thing like the end of the magical ride. You were talking about the ride. The ride goes on and on and on. There is no finish line.
It's cyclic.
There is no finish line. So we should learn to work slowly, to pace ourselves, but with the maximum torque that we push through.
Walk slowly and never expect that there are many followers. This is another wisdom I definitely took from my mother. So now the grandmothers and the mothers' wisdoms come in. Yet again, it's this idea that when the ideas you're having might sound strange to the people you're talking to, might sound too nouveau, too far off, too naive, to all those kind of criticism you might harvest when you're coming up with new ideas. It maybe on one hand that you are also wrong, so always accept this possibility, but failure is an option, and as you said, that's so beautiful with art, or with looking at art, with experiencing art, at least there's one area where you're not being measured against, yeah, are you a good perceptioner of art or not, although it's a long discussion, some people feel even afraid of looking at art because they might not be well equipped to look at it, yet what I really want to say now is, if you come up with an idea and you are in a room with, I don't know, 10 people or 50 or 60 or hundreds, don't expect that all will follow your ideas and go straight with you and be fully on your side, and that your idea will be the perfect solution to a wicked problem. There are no perfect solutions to wicked problems, but we are in times of wicked problems and grand challenges. So it's the tiny steps and it's the small groups. It's like Margaret Mead said, never doubt that a small group of people ever accomplished change. It's in fact the only thing that ever did. I think many of you know this quote. And this is why I'm saying this right now to close this round is that, of course, the barriers, the boundaries, you all and we are currently confronted with coming up with those new ideas are also energy sucking. Of course, it's super difficult. But then again, look for the people who are with you, and it's a very resource-oriented way to look only at these and not the 10, 50, hundreds of others. It's not about wasting time. It's not about wasting energy, really. Look at where are your resources and keep your energies together. It's quite difficult to write where in. Thank you. Thank you, all of you. Thank you, Indy, to London. Hope to see you soon somewhere else.